Hello again, you lovely people of the social. I'm not in my room this week. Those kind people have gave me a set because I'm interviewing Juno Dawson right here on this couch. This is where her bum will be. So yeah, let's get into this. Enjoy. The BBC have kindly gave me a set this week instead of my bedroom.
Look, it's so lovely.
It's pretty lush.
It's fancy.
It's done a good job. So I do a lot of gender-based stuff here, and obviously you came out to the world about 18 months ago now, wasn't it?
Less. I mean, I had told a lot of friends and family beforehand. I sort of got all my ducks in a row. And it was a strange one. I had to sort of decide, is this something you sort of want to do publicly, or do you want to take a couple of years off and then kind of come back as Juno, like as a finished product? And I decided that was crazy. And so I was at an awards ceremony last autumn, and I was speaking to my dear friend Patrick Stridwick, the journalist, and he was like, well, why don't we do an interview for BuzzFeed? And so I thought, well, actually, as naff as it sounds, BuzzFeed is not naff, but the whole idea of me publicly coming out was ridiculous. But then I thought, well, at least then I can just do it once. Yeah. And for the rest of time, if anybody's like, what, you're trans now? I'll be like, here's the article, enjoy.
Yeah, I should have done that, yeah. Actually. But
half an hour.
Yeah. I mean, how do you find it? Like, because you were in the public eye when you were writing previously, and you kind of had your YouTube channel vlogging, especially when you did your previous book. How do you feel when you see, because for a lot of people, they don't like their dead name or their previous name being known, but you know, you didn't really have that option.
Am I allowed to say shit?
Yeah, go for it.
I couldn't give two shits. I mean, there were seven books with James on, that I'm really proud of, like really, really proud. And one of the first questions that came up is, what do we do with those books? And particularly, This Book Is Gay has sold all around the world. You know, I'm not gonna try erase anything that I achieved. It's a really personal thing for me, but I think it's a mistake for anyone, cis or trans, to erase their past, because it's your past, it's such a vital part of your tapestry of what makes you you. And, you know, I'm very proud of the things I achieved when I was Cole James, and I'm sure I will continue to be proud of the things I do when I'm Juno. Stick a rock. Always been the same through the middle.
Okay, yeah, no, I like that. Yeah, because, I mean, for me, it's always been one of those, like, yeah, I've done lots of stuff, but I find that when I'm talking about myself previously, I've obviously changed pronouns and name and everything now, but I still find it hard when people who do know my dead name still sometimes occasionally slip out, and you're really a bit like... But that's just personal to me, and that's kind of what's really great about transitioning, is that it is your own personal way of doing it.
I mean, I have had people telling me I'm doing it wrong. Like, why? Because there was a period I didn't start Juno until this January, and there was that period between the BuzzFeed article in October and January the 1st, where everything became Juno, where people are like, oh no, you shouldn't still be using that name, you shouldn't be using that name. And I'm like, please do not tell me what's right for me, and I won't tell you what's right for you. There's as many ways to be trans as there are trans people.
Yeah, no, completely. And do you find that that came from social media a lot? Do you feel like, because there is quite a big social conversation going on at the moment?
A little bit. A lot of, you know, I was asked many, many times, is it he or she? What do I refer to you as? And I was like, do you know, big things to worry about, to be honest. But I'm slightly more forgiving. Like, my forgiveness scale is directly proportionate to how long you've known me. Mm-hmm. So like, my mum will always be forgiven for getting it wrong because she's known me since before I was born. Whereas if you are, for example, a makeup artist who has just met me, this happened the other day, a makeup artist on a TV show met me and said, oh, I finished on his makeup. I'm like, you've just put a face full of women's makeup on my face, and yet you just said that. Like, are you in some way blind, or you know, can you not see what you've just done? I mean, and so I'm not massively bothered, but even I was like, come on.
Yeah.
And if we just met, I'm called Juno, and you've just put a lot of makeup on me.
Is that the worst misgendering situation you've had, or?
I think that was the one that really stood out because it was a makeup artist, and I was like, so I think there was kind of a day shortly after January where I sort of thought, right, you really do now have to kind of go for it. And getting the hair extensions, which have now come out, but the extensions was a big thing because it looked so female and so feminine that a lot of people stopped misgendering. But more's the point, I think everyone clocked that, I think possibly that's a trans woman, but whatever it is, it's definitely trying to be a woman. And, you know, the intent was there. And so people, whether they've clocked the trans part or not, they can definitely see that I'm working towards woman. And they, I would say 99% of people respect that.
Do you feel that there is that pressure for trans people in general to suddenly go, you know, full presentation and think, I need to do everything I can to help pass? Do you think that's a problem with trans people or the way that society, for example, with us trans women, looks at us and think that we have to be picture-perfect femininity, you know? Mm. Like, because when I came out, I instantly thought, oh, I've got to all be like this and that. Mm. And then as I went further along, I'm just like, yeah, whatever.
I think it's definitely society's problem. And I think the goal for anyone, again, cis or trans, is to truly live the way they want to. You know, for example, I feel when I had the hair extensions in, I must admit, I felt almost too girly. I almost felt this isn't quite me. And one of my friends, an author called Laura Dockrell, you know, she has this phase which is Hollyoaks pretty. And I think yeah. that's something to avoid. No offense to the cast of Hollyoaks, but it's quite, you know, that sort of the big hair, the tan, the false eyelashes. That's not really what I'm going for. I've always been a bit of a rock chick at heart.
Yeah.
But even before I knew it.
And you mentioned the media there, and that's something I'm heavy passionate about, is with the tipping point being, what, 2014, 2015, you know, we've got Laverne Cox on the cover of Time magazine, and then trans issues just out of nowhere exploded mm-hmm. into the press. And as you say, the press is pretty transphobic and pretty poor when it comes to talking about us. How do you feel we've moved on, if anything, or are we moving backwards?
I think the difference is that we are now in the press. I mean, it's so strange that just this morning I was tweeting Caroline Cossey, who obviously massively came up against it in the 80s and yeah. 90s. And you know, I'm so grateful to those early pioneers, the April Ashleys, Caroline Cossey, through to Paris Lees, you know, who took a lot of flack in the first part of the century as well. And I mean, thank God Paris is so eloquent. But now I think all of a sudden, and we do, I think, have to mention Ms. Jenner, that Ms. Jenner, however you feel about her politics or her lifestyle, she was so famous that there is now not a single person, probably in the world, who now isn't aware of what a transgender person is. And for that, I guess we owe her a debt of gratitude.
Yeah.
And so now, I mean, in the 90s it was called the post-Ellen moment, and I think truly now we are in the post-Caitlyn moment. But the post-Caitlyn moment does also encompass Laverne Cox, mm-hmm. Harry Neff, Andre Page.
Jamie Clayton,
Laith, and
you know, yeah,
Adrian Dowling, and all those people, you know, and so now it's almost like we're here, but they don't know quite what to do with us. But I think there's an effort. Like the other night, I was on Channel 4 News talking about the EU referendum, and for me, that's a real step forward. A trans woman on a news program not talking about being trans.
Yeah.
And yes, some human rights stuff did come up, but that was because I steered the conversation that way, because that's one of the reasons I want to stay in Europe. But no, I thought it's seeing green shoots. I'd say that's the stage we're at. We're seeing little green shoots in the media popping up.
Yeah, and I just still get really upset when you see, we take newspapers, for example, who decide how they want to report us. And especially with, you know, things like, we're seeing a lot of people still telling their coming out stories. Mm-hmm. Do you feel that we need to move forward from that a bit?
You can never have too many of those coming out stories, because again, if yours is the one that just catches the eye of that person who is going through the questioning process, mm-hmm. who is just starting in the sort of the curiosity stage, then I think it's important, because, you know, we aren't all catch-all. You know, some people will have seen my coming out story, some people have seen yours, some people have seen Fox Fisher's, some people have seen Jack Monroe's, and it's just the one that you happen to find. Both of my coming out stories, both as a gay man and as a trans woman, were quite low-key, actually. They were quite lo-fi, because I think the other danger is that if you read enough stories about very depressed, very suicidal young people coming out as LGBT, then there is almost the assumption that, oh, well, this must be something that's fundamentally depressing or negative. Mm. Whereas actually, and I think Wayne does this very well at the website as well, areyoucomingout.com, I think is really celebrate the positive changes that happen in your life once you are living more authentically.
Yeah, no, because I've read that actually. I did read your book and you were talking about how that people can find support groups, but if the support group is quite toxic and negative, then that kind of almost breeds into yourself.
Mm.
And there are places on the internet to go for help, but if you end up in the wrong ones, like I did when I started, and I had people telling me I was doing it wrong. You're not girly enough. You should be doing this, you should be doing that. And it's like, looking back on that time now, I really wish I could tell those people to shove it, you know? But what you said there was really interesting about, you know, finding yourself and coming out. Like, to people that are questioning, you know, their gender in any way, shape or form, you know, what would you say to them? What advice would you give them?
Oh, it's hard. I get letters all the time. Since This Book Is Gay came out, I've more than anything else, I get letters about, you know, how can I come out? Mm. And the problem is there's just no one way to do it. It's about what I always say to particularly young people is, what support have you got and are you safe? Mm. Because if you know, in a choice between waiting a couple of years until you're off at university and being homeless at 14, maybe keep a lid on it.
Yeah.
You know, but, you know, similarly, and I told some friends when I was about 15, certainly about my sexuality anyway, that, you know, I knew I was with a group of friends that I was safe with. Like, I really, truly had a gut feeling. And, you know, I think there's a lot to be said for gut feelings. And if your gut feeling is telling you, no, is not the time to come out, then maybe listen to that. You know, very often we're like, come out, what are you waiting for? Come out, come out.
Yeah.
It isn't always safe or right or appropriate for people to come out. And the other thing that I always say to young people is, you've got all the time in the world. You know, transitioning at its heart is painfully slow. You've got time.
You learn
so
patience.
Much time. Yeah, and so have patience and speak to other people. You'll speak to some people you disagree with. You'll speak to some people you agree with. Find your tribe, you know, because again, there is not one trans experience and there's a million different ways to be trans. And you will, you know, I'm very much at the beginning of making my own trans community, you know, having sort of left behind the gay community and sort of, you know, working towards now just, I guess, being a heterosexual woman, which is a whole new ball game.
Yeah. Mm. How have you found that, actually? Because like you say, you were previously, you know, presenting and defining as a gay male, which I actually did that under the guise of an excuse just to wear makeup when I was like, you know, looking like that. How have you found like your views towards society and even your writing? How do you think all that has changed since coming out and starting your transition?
I don't know, have you read my glamour column this month is all about dating. That's an eye-opener.
I read your Tinder article this morning. Mm. Yeah, that's fun.
It's been interesting.
How many dirty pics have you had so far?
But then I think straight away a lot of cisgender women were starting me saying, welcome to Tinder, that's just Tinder. So I feel maybe a little bit hard done by now. I thought I was special. Sadly not, no.
It's a weird form of validation,
yeah,
isn't
that's gonna,
it?
Oh wow, I'm really normal. Great. But I don't know if it's affected my work. I certainly don't get asked anymore, why do you write such good female characters? Because that question defined like the first 4 years of my writing.
Yeah.
I'm not sure, I think it's the non-fiction. I think for the first time that I'm properly living now without any secrets. I think there was lots of sub-secrets, but there was always one big secret. So a secret for a long time, it was a secret from me. But I realized that actually the more time I spend living as Juno, the more at ease I feel and the less shame. And shame is a very evocative word. I'm reading a book by Matthew Todd at the moment, who's the editor of Attitude. It's called The Straitjacket, and it very much talks about, he likens it to child abuse. He said young LGBT people in so many ways are told they're wrong. It borders on abuse, you know, and how do we survive that and how do we grow into well-adjusted adults? And I'm not sure I was a well-adjusted adult until maybe 2 years ago. And so the thing now, because I feel a lot more at ease with myself and my past, and again, speaking about, you know, what's gone before, I'm actually properly ready to write about it for the first time.
Yeah.
And you'll notice I've written novels, I've written nonfiction, but I've never written about myself. So the one big change is that I feel
ready
now to tell that. And it's not all pretty, but, you know, I'm not embarrassed anymore and I'm not ashamed of it.
With the children, there's a lot of talk about, you know, letting kids explore their gender identity at a young age, and there's a massive backlash about that. I mean, what would you say to people who are like that? We shouldn't be allowing our kids to be themselves.
For me, the advice is always just, I think we should listen to children, because children, very young children, often haven't learned to lie. Mm-hmm. And so I think the things that very young children say are very often very truthful.
Yeah.
And I think there's two periods to listen to children in particular. One is when they're very young. You know, had you asked me at three, here's the pink pill, do you want to be a girl? I would have been like, absolutely. Yeah. And it would have been a very honest, unfiltered answer. Then when I think, and I know this when I was a teacher, children get cruel and judgmental around 7 or 8 years old. It's like they've stopped being quite so self-centered. And I think that's when a lot of children learn to shut down, mm-hmm. and a lot of children learn to self-protect themselves by kind of going in on themselves.
Yeah.
And I think that's the other time we should be particularly wary of what children are saying to us. A lot of that sort of frantic kind of trans horror about children as young as 9 are transitioning into women or men. I'm like, no, they're not.
Yeah.
This is bad journalism. Mm-hmm. You know, possibly they've been put on some hormone blockers to buy time. But crikey, I wish I'd have had that option.
Yeah, completely.
I wouldn't have had my shoulders, which I know I'm stuck with. Yeah. So, you know, and it's just, you know, giving young people time and space to think things through, how can that ever be a bad thing?
No, I know, completely. It's fascinating because I think that's around 7 or 8 was when I was like, oh no, I can't say anything mm-hmm. now, you know? Especially after all those kind of years of, you know, you hide away and you wait for everyone to mm-hmm. Yeah. And the last thing I'd like to say, because this goes out to a mixture of trans people and cis people, what would you say to cisgender society? What would you like to say to cisgender society? How's it doing?
I think pretty well. I think it's a learning process, and I think it's a process that's happening in lots of different ways about lots of different groups. I think for a long time, you know, the UK was able to kid itself that it was not a diverse place to live. And, you know, we see a variation of the same conversation happening a lot about mental illness, about Gypsy Roma travellers, about trans people, about lesbian and gay people, about bisexual people. And it's about sort of adjusting to just accommodate everyone. I mean, gosh, I mean, the biggest scaremongering at the moment is around Islam and around Muslims, mm-hmm. you know, and I think, gosh, if anything, trans people are getting a much easier ride in the press than Muslims. Yeah. And it is about fear. It's about trying to understand the similarities between us before looking at the differences. And I think by understanding that all transgender people want is pretty much the same things as cisgender people. Yeah. Roof over our heads, a steady job, legal protections. You know, we don't want to lose our jobs for our gender. We want relationships, we want comfort, we want fast broadband, you know. and I think that's kind of, if we could start with those things, I think we'll get a lot further. But like I've said, I seem to just be meeting people who are trying really hard, and people do seem to be kind of really working on it.
And getting there.
We'll
get there, eventually. Mm-hmm. But listen, thank you so
much
for taking the time to speak to me.
It's been an absolute
pleasure.
It's been a blast.